welcome to Redwood. I'm Kate, the Worship and Creative Arts intern. We're so glad that you're joining us online for the fourth week of our Advent series. This morning, Melissa is going to be talking on the peace that Jesus brings. I'm going to read a verse from Philippians 4, verses 4 to 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition and with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So let's rejoice in the Lord together this morning.
I was lost in darkness, I've seen a light. The Savior promised, revealed tonight. Those hearts in waiting, they wait no more. This manger baby, he is Lord. Oh, let all the earth join heaven's song. The death of death, the end of fear, join to
tuning in with us today. Whether you found us on purpose or if you just happened upon us on YouTube, we're so glad you're here. My name is Jesse. I'm one of the pastors at Redwood, and I am so excited because we are getting into the week of Christmas, which is so hard to believe, but we are so excited. I've got a couple things to share with you about it. But before we do, I just want to let you know, if you are prepared to give this morning, if you'd like to give to the work that Redwood is doing in our city, I want to invite you to do that. You can do that through our Tithely app. It's a great app. You can get it on any smartphone, and you can give to the work that Redwood's doing, and we would appreciate it so much. And we're so thankful for all of you who have given so faithfully and so obediently throughout this year. The other thing that I want to let you know is there's an opportunity this week for our Christmas services. We believe in radical generosity. We think that we are called to give. We are called to give sacrificially to the people around us who really need it. And so in order to do that, really well this Christmas. For our Christmas services, we have partnered with the RFDA, and we are going to be giving 100% of the money that comes in for those services to the RFDA. You can do that through the Tithely app. Just come prepared to do that. We'll give you lots of details on how to do that. But we really want you to be prepared, because we want to come out and we want to be prepared to be generous. We want to plan to be generous. And that's going to be a great way. So those services are going to happen on the 23rd and 24th. And at 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock, you can find us right here. We'll be live on YouTube. And we'd love for you to join in. We'd love for you to invite people, send the link to everyone, send people, you know, your family. It doesn't matter. You can do it all over the country. And you can tune in and you can hop in the chat and you can, you know, communicate and talk. We're really excited. We've got an amazing service planned. And we're really excited for you to join us on the 23rd and 24th at 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock. And we know that this year is a little bit weird. It's a little bit different just because of all the COVID regulations. And we understand that. And so much of Christmas is always about gathering and, you know, you get excited. And it's hard to do that this year. And so one thing that we wanted to do and that we're going to do on Tuesday, the 22nd from 6 to 8 p.m. is the Christmas lights drive-through. And so what we're going to do is in our parking lot, we are going to set everything up really safely, socially distant. You're going to stay in your car, but there's going to be some lights. There's going to be some music. But we want you to invite you to come drive through, and we're going to have popcorn and we're going to have hot chocolate and hot apple cider and all kinds of things. And so you can come through with your families or with, you know, some close friends if they're in your, you know, little small circle, and then go, and there's a light tour around Thunder Bay. And it's a great way to just, you know, still get out of the house and celebrate and prepare for Christmas. And we want to help you do that. So you can come here first, grab a hot drink, grab some popcorn, and we would be so excited. So we're going to continue with our service this morning, and we just invite you to engage, participate as we celebrate Christmas this year, 2020.
Today is the fourth and last Sunday of Advent, a season of the year set apart to help us remember the coming of Christ at Christmas and His coming again in the future. Advent means arrival, and so for each of the four Sundays of Advent, we have shared a reading, lit a candle, and prayed, all in an effort to help us look back on Christ's arrival as a baby and look forward to Christ's arrival in the future. In this Advent season of waiting on the Lord, we affirm again our trust in God's goodness. For with the Lord there is great love and redemption. God, you are our healer. You dispense hope and bring repair. There is no darkness with you. We ask God that as we wait for you, you would forgive and forget our sins. We ask God that as we wait for you, you remember your love. We delight in you, God. As we wait, share with us the gift of being able to taste and see your goodness. Enliven all our senses that we might be aware of you in all our immensity and nearness. Help us hold on until we see your leading. Help us hold on until we see your coming. Let's pray together. Jesus, love of all loves, hope of all hopes, light of all lights, come be with us today. As we look to you, as we long for you, fill our souls with strength to endure. Bring your word of mercy, your word of gladness, your word of friendship, and your word of challenge to us. As the light from this wreath begins to increase, so also increase our readiness and love to serve you. You, God, are our beginning and our end. You are our everlasting light. Arise and shine upon us, Jesus, that we might walk in your light. Amen.
see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do.
Hello and welcome to Redwood Park Church from wherever you happen to be watching today. My name is Melissa and I'm the executive pastor here. Today is the fourth Sunday of Advent. It's the season where we've been joining into the Christmas story. We've been walking alongside God's people as they're waiting for the Messiah to be born, this baby who would change humanity. But 10 years ago, another baby was born. This baby, like Jesus, would grow up and he wouldn't be like people would expect him to be. This baby's name is Bone Digger. Now, you might be thinking this is kind of a weird name for a human child. This wasn't a human child. Bone Digger is a lion. Bone Digger was born with a rare metabolic disease, which gave him brittle bones. His zookeeper knew that he probably needed a little extra care, kind of a parental figure. So the zookeeper introduced Bone Digger to his little dachshund, his little dog, Milo. I think I have a picture of Milo and Bone Digger together when they met for the first time. This first time they met, Bone Digger was actually afraid of Milo. Even though Bone Digger at 4 months old could kill him with one swipe of his paw, he weighed much more, but he was a little bit timid. The zookeeper believes that Milo came in and took charge and took care of him because he sensed Bone Digger's disability. Milo would play with Bone Digger, would groom Bone Digger, would raise him, and now as adults, they are friends. This particular story enjoyed some viral popularity. It spread throughout the internet in about very, very briefly in 2014. So maybe you've seen this picture before. We saw this heartwarming hope through this compassionate strength of this little dog who is caring for somebody who he should have been afraid of, and this lion who denied his predatory urge to hurt Milo. What was it about this image that drew people to it and caused this viral popularity? Over the past 4 weeks, we've been exploring the book of Isaiah, the prophet who lived 700 years before Jesus was born. Isaiah was pointing ahead to when a new king would come. This king would mysteriously be sent by God, but also was God. In Isaiah's description of this king, we see that the world looks very different under his rule. Instead of a king who is a predator, the kind of king that the people of Israel were used to, the kind of king who used his power and his privilege to oppress people for his own gain, this new king, Jesus, would come with humility, with wisdom, justice, compassion, and love. Last week, if you tuned in, Jay spoke about this king from Isaiah 11, 1-5. Jay talked about how Jesus does not judge the world or judge us as the world judges because he sees into our hearts, how he makes decisions on behalf of the most poor and the most vulnerable, how he would put people into their proper places. And as a result of that leadership, as a result of his reign, the world would be transformed. Today, we're going to look at that transformation. So last week, Jay was speaking on Isaiah 11, 1-5, and I'm going to pick up right where he left off with verses 6-9. We're going to read Isaiah 11, verses 6-9. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put his hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea." Before we move on, let's just pause and pray. God, we long for your peace. Show us through the words of Isaiah the prophet what peace looks like and how we can experience it this Christmas. So in my opening story that featured Bone Digger and Milo, we saw a picture of peace that was a little bit like what Isaiah is talking about in our passage today. Some people have interpreted Isaiah's words literally, that when Jesus comes again, when he finishes what he started with his birth and his death and his resurrection, and when he establishes a new heaven and a new earth, there will be an ecological reordering. We will return to kind of a Garden of Eden state where animals and humans live in harmony with one another. We coexist peacefully. And while there is some merit to this interpretation, there's a little bit more going on, especially when we consider that the genre, the style of writing most common in the book of Isaiah is poetry. This is a beautiful piece of poetry. And when we read it like this, we see this as a metaphor. It's a figure of speech illustrating a broader truth, that God's rule through Jesus brings peace. And not peace that is merely the absence of conflict. It's what is given in place of that. This peace that's given in the place of that absence of conflict is shalom. Shalom is a Hebrew word that means wholeness or completion. I really like this definition that one scholar wrote. He said this: "The webbing together of God, humans, and all of creation in justice, fulfillment, and delight is what the Hebrew prophets called shalom. We call it peace, but it means far more than peace of mind or a ceasefire between enemies. In the Bible, shalom means universal flourishing, wholeness, and delight. It inspires joyful wonder as the Creator and Savior opens the doors and welcomes the creatures in whom he delights. Shalom, in other words, is the way that things are supposed to be." It's what happens between Bone Digger and Milo. They're flourishing, they're delighting in one another. And as we watch their relationship, we are moved into wonder and joy. This is the shalom that Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the Prince of Shalom, brings. So today we're going to explore this idea of shalom. And we're going to answer these two questions. Number one, what is shalom? And number two, who is shalom for? The peace that Jesus brings is more than just our personal shalom. It's about the shalom, the wholeness, the completion of the entire world. This is a message for all of creation. So let's start with, what is shalom? I am the oldest of three siblings. First it was me, then my sister Krista, and then my brother Maury. There's 5 years difference between me and Maury. I remember when Maury was born. I remember when he was a toddler and we used to dress him up in our tutus. I'm sorry, Maury, I know you might be watching this. I apologize for telling everybody about your tutu wearing days. I remember when Maury was in kindergarten and I would watch him play on the playground from my grade 4 classroom. I remember Maury's soccer games and his hockey games. I remember when Maury graduated. When I think about my relationship with my brother Maury, it was fairly uneventful. We didn't fight a lot. If I'm being totally honest, when we were teenagers, we were fairly indifferent towards one another, me towards him and him towards me, probably similar to a lot of teenage brothers and sisters who are 5 years apart. So does this mean that we had a peaceful relationship? If your definition of peace is the absence of conflict, then I suppose it was. But if your definition of peace comes from God's definition of peace, which is flourishing and friendship, well, we didn't really have a friendship at that point. So I don't know if you would call our relationship peaceful. There was a bit of a false peace. Something happened though, when my brother was about 19, he developed a relationship with my husband, Jay. They became great friends. And then he and I became great friends. We used to hang out on the weekends. We went on a road trip together. We would spend weekends at the lake. We discovered we had the same sense of humor and we laughed a lot. We also discovered that we liked to cook and we liked to eat good food. Eventually, we shared the same faith. Now I can say as adults that Maury is one of my best friends. There's a shalom quality to our relationship where we desire the flourishing of one another, where our relationship brings delight and joy. In this great little book called Making Peace, the author Jim Van Eyperen says there's a difference between peacekeeping and peacemaking. Keeping the peace is simply just trying to smooth things down so everything is calm on the surface. So it's not addressing the underlying issues. It's sweeping things under the rug. It's not dealing with things. It looks like peace, but below the surface, it's anything but. Making peace is about dealing with the things that are under the surface that cause relational breakdowns that lead to true relationship. Making peace comes from Jesus because peace from Jesus is different than the peace that the world brings. Jesus, the Prince of Peace, he came to make peace. This is how he did it. Jay talked about it last week. Jesus rules with wisdom. He rules with understanding. And he judges fairly. He makes decisions for the poor. And in the passage that Jay talked about last week, it says that he slays the wicked. Now, that's a bit of a heavy, harsh statement. Does it mean that Jesus will get rid of all the bad guys? Is this, when it says that he will make peace and he will slay the wicked, is it because the bad guys are somehow doomed, that there's no hope for the bad guys? You know, as a result of the rule that Jesus will bring, we actually read something a little bit different in the text today. We see all of these relationships between seemingly good guys and bad guys, but they're in a friendship with one another. There's the wolf and the lamb. There's a leopard and a goat, a calf and a lion, a cow and a bear, a child and a snake. Under Jesus' rule, he doesn't just picture them living peacefully side by side. He pictures them together in a relationship, flowing out of a friendship with Jesus. So let's just take a look at that first pair for a moment. The wolf will live with the lamb. Now, wolves are pretty notorious predators. We see it in our folk tales and our fairy tales. Think about the three little pigs. The three little pigs are on the run from the wolf who's trying to blow down their house and devour them. Or the Little Red Riding Hood. Little Red Riding Hood's grandmother has been eaten by a wolf, and now the wolf is in the grandmother's bed waiting for Little Red Riding Hood so he can trick her and he can devour her. Even in the Bible, wolves are not portrayed very well. Jesus calls predatory leaders at one point as wolves dressed up in sheep's clothing, meaning the wolf is a sly predator whose goal is to deceive and to kill. So when Isaiah talks about a wolf here lying down with a lamb, he's saying something pretty significant. Isaiah says the wolf will live with the lamb. Other Bible translations say the wolf will dwell with the lamb, or the wolf will sojourn with the lamb. They're living together. And notice that the wolf is in the lamb's territory. Normally, this would mean that the lamb is in great danger. But Isaiah is picturing something different, and he's pushing the metaphor to the extreme. It's not that the wolf is somehow changed, and now he's welcoming the lamb and taking the lamb under his arm to take care of the lamb. It's the opposite. The wolf is seeking shelter and protection with the lamb. The wolf is with the lamb in the lamb's home. The second image is pretty similar. It's the leopard will lie down with the goat. Again, Isaiah flips this idea of predator and prey upside down. The goat, the weak one, has welcomed the leopard into its place of rest because the goat's fear is gone. The goat can enter into sleep, a place of complete vulnerability, with somebody whose natural instinct is actually to gobble him up. But in this set of relationships, the predators no longer eat the animals. They eat with the animals. Isaiah says the cow will feed with the bear. The bear is not feeding on the cow. They're feeding with each other. They're having a meal with one another. They're enjoying hospitality and the company of one another. This is an intimate act to eat together. And the reason why they're able to do this is because the appetite of the predators have changed. Isaiah says this, the lion will eat straw like an ox. What I find so interesting about these images is that Isaiah is not just picturing shalom for the weakest. It's shalom for all. The predators have been disarmed. They are no longer a threat. They are free to enter into a relationship with their previous prey without the danger that they're going to hurt them anymore. And the prey can welcome them in, provide hospitality, because they are no longer afraid. God's peace, God's shalom, is restoring both the oppressor and the oppressed. So this brings us to our second question today. Who is shalom for? Simply put, shalom is for everyone. And because we are complex creatures, it's hard to categorize people into good guys and bad guys. We have all been in the place of the oppressed and the oppressor. The fact that shalom is for everyone, this is good news. But remember, shalom flows out of our relationship with God. There's this famous king in the Bible named David. He shows us what it's like to experience shalom that starts with God, whether you are an oppressor or whether you are the oppressed. King David had a deep relationship with God. The Bible tells us that David was a man after God's heart. He was a worshiper too. He wrote many of the Psalms in the Bible. He ruled fairly. He's considered one of the greatest kings of Israel. But we see in David's story that because he is human, he was both the oppressed and the oppressor. At some points in David's life, he was oppressed. He was the lamb or the goat or the cow or the child. He was in danger. Near the beginning of his life, he was on the run from a jealous king, the man who came before him. And near the end of his life, he was on the run from a jealous son, the son who wanted to come after him. But in his darkest moment, David was also the oppressor. He was more of a wolf. He used his power and his privilege in one particular instant to sleep with a married woman. And when she got pregnant, he killed her husband. This is pretty wolfish behavior. Out of that incident, David wrote Psalm 32 about carrying the weight of the guilt. He wrote this, "When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer." There is no shalom. There is no peace for the oppressor. Oftentimes, an act of oppression comes from an inner sense of inadequacy. As in, I don't feel good about myself, so I've got to bring somebody else down. Or I've got to climb over the weakest to climb the ladder to fill some insatiable need for success. Without God's shalom, the completeness, the wholeness, that only comes when we have a relationship with Jesus, the appetites of the oppressor will never be satisfied. But for those oppressors who truly confess and turn to Jesus, his shalom is available. This is good news because we've all been in the place of the oppressor, but this is not a weak shalom. It's not peacekeeping. It's peacemaking and is costly. It's costly for Jesus who went to the cross, but it's costly for us too. After writing about the anguish that David felt after his sin against the married woman and her husband, David wrote this, "Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity." See, did not cover it up, did not engage in peacekeeping. He said, "I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." David confesses his sin to God. He asks for forgiveness, and God forgives. There are still consequences to his actions, but David is willing to accept those consequences because he knows that a life without God is going to be bad. It will only bring more torment. Real transformation comes out of a relationship with Jesus. Isaiah tells us that this transformation is so radical that when the wolf, the leopard, the bear, and the lion choose to follow him, he disarms them. He changes their appetite. And this disarmament is not easy. It's painful to give up old ways and old habits, the things that we do to protect ourselves but that hurt others. It's hard to give up the things underneath that are driving our appetites, but Jesus can set the oppressor free from the things that drives them. The only thing that satisfies our appetites, the only way that the predator can be transformed from a predator to a friend is through Jesus. In our reading today, Isaiah's given us a pretty amazing picture. The predator and the prey are living in harmony with one another. Now, for some people, in an abusive situation, this is not wise. It is not wise to live with your oppressor. The best thing to do is to get out of the abusive situation and know that it is evil and that it is wrong. The shalom that Isaiah is talking about in this passage is what will happen when Jesus comes back again, when he transforms the entire world. Remember what Jay talked about last week. Jesus will judge the wicked of the world. He will make decisions for the most vulnerable. His perfect justice means that he will not stand for the oppression of the weakest. He will not stand for the predators who prey on the most vulnerable. If the oppressor refuses to confess, refuses to turn to Jesus, refuses God's transformation, rejects his offer of shalom, it will not be possible for that oppressor to be in the new heaven and the new earth where we are promised that there will be no more crying, no more death, no more mourning, and no more pain. Because how could there be no more crying, death, mourning, or pain if the predator is there? The last line of our reading today from Isaiah confirms this. Isaiah said, the oppressor will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain. For as the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. Isaiah is pointing out that in this new heaven and this new earth, the predators will no longer harm and destroy because the whole earth will know God, will be in a relationship with Jesus, which will result in relationships with one another. And this happens as the predators are disarmed through the love of Jesus. But the lambs, the goats, the calves, and the children have a role to play in this shalom. There's a few hurdles. Again, this is going to require the transformation of Jesus. Because just as we are forgiven when we hurt people, Jesus asks. Now, he doesn't just ask. He actually commands that we forgive others as we've been forgiven. I have been in an abusive situation before. I will be the first to admit that forgiveness is so hard. Just when I think I've forgiven the person who hurt me, something triggers the feelings of shame and hurt, and I find that I have to forgive them again. But to remain in a state of unforgiveness, that's not peace. That is not shalom. Nelson Mandela says that unforgiveness is like drinking poison and then hoping our enemies will die. When we refuse to forgive, we are the ones that suffer. But forgiveness is hard. Jesus knows that. That's why we need his transformation. Forgiveness is possible when these things happen. When we realize that we, like David, have sinned, when we have broken relationships, when we have hurt others, and we are just as much in need of forgiveness as the people who have hurt us. When we receive the forgiveness of Jesus, it makes it easier to forgive others. And the second thing is, especially if we've experienced trauma or abuse, forgiveness happens when we are transformed by Jesus' healing love. And whether or not the oppressor asks for forgiveness, whether or not the oppressor turns to Jesus and is transformed, we release the burden of judgment to God, and God will judge them as he sees fit. Our role is not to judge. We weren't meant to carry that burden. We're meant to release it to Jesus. And in our imperfect, fallen world, when we know Jesus and we can release this burden, we can experience shalom now. Transformation is possible. I'm going to close with a story to illustrate this. This is a pretty amazing story, but it shows that through Jesus, anything is possible. Corrie ten Boom was a Dutch Christian who lived during World War II in Holland. When the Nazis occupied Holland, she and her family worked to help Jews escape. But she and her sister were captured, and they were sent to Ravensbrück concentration camp. At the concentration camp, Corey's sister died, tragically. But when the war ended, through the transformation of Jesus, Corey was able to forgive. And she ended up traveling through Germany, spreading this message of God's forgiveness. After one particular talk, after she had just been talking about how when we confess our sins, God casts them into the deepest ocean, gone forever, a man approached her, and she immediately recognized him as one of the guards at the Ravensbrück concentration camp. When he approached her, all of the memories of her trauma, of what happened there, came flooding back to her. She wrote this. Corey Ten Boom says this. The memory came back with a rush. The huge room with its harsh overhead lights, the pathetic pile of dresses and shoes in the center of the floor, the shame of walking naked past this man. I could see my sister's frail form ahead of me, ribs sharp beneath the parchment skin. My sister and I had been arrested for concealing Jews in our home during the Nazi occupation of Holland. This man had been the guard at Ravensbrück, where we had been sent. Now he was in front of me, hand thrust out. A fine message, Fräulein. How good to know that you, as you say, or how good it is to know that, as you say, our sins are at the bottom of the sea. And I, she wrote, who had spoken so glibly of forgiveness, fumbled with my pocketbook rather than take his hand. She goes on to say that the guard talked about how since the Ravensbrück concentration camp, he had become a Christian, how he had experienced God's forgiveness. And in that moment, he asked Corey to forgive him as well. Now, Corey had a dilemma. How could she forgive this man who played a part in her sister's death? How could she forgive this man who had caused so much pain? Yet, how could she not forgive him, especially when she was traveling around talking about God's forgiveness? She knew that God was asking her to forgive him. Yet, Corey writes this, and still I stood there with the coldness clutching my heart. But forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. I'm just going to say that sentence one more time because I think it's important. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. Jesus, help me, I prayed silently. Corey prayed silently. I can lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling. And so woodenly, mechanically, Corey thrust her hand into the one outstretched before her. And as she did, an incredible thing took place. She said, the current started in my shoulder, raced down my arm, sprang down into our joined hands, and then this healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. I forgive you, she cried, with all my heart. She says, for a long moment, we grasped each other's hands, former guard and former prisoner. She said she had never known God's love so intensely as she did in that moment. This is shalom. This is shalom. And this shalom comes from Jesus. Jesus, who knew oppression. The God of the universe who shrunk himself down into the form of a baby. The Prince of Peace placed in a manger. The child who was a refugee in Egypt. The man without a place to call home, dependent on the goodness of others. The leader of a movement who rides into Jerusalem on a donkey. The king who dies the humiliating death of a criminal, even though he did no wrong. Jesus, the Lamb who was slain. Jesus, the Lamb who was slain. And yet Isaiah pictures the lion laying down with the lamb. This happens because paradoxically, Jesus is also the lion. When Jesus comes back, when he restores everything, when the whole earth truly is filled with the knowledge of God, we read in the last book of the Bible about Jesus, who is the lamb who was slain, but at the same time, he is the lion of Judah, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, who has triumphed. But Jesus, the lion, is not a predatory lion. Jesus the Lion uses his power to bring about hard-won shalom, when the real predators of sin and death have been removed and disarmed, and we can live with, lay down with, eat with, abide with the Lion, the Lamb, Jesus. This Christmas, do you want to experience the shalom that Jesus brings? I know I do. It starts with prayer. And so let's close in a moment of prayer. Father in heaven, you shrunk down into the form of a baby. You walk this earth as a man. You are oppressed. You are abused. You are the Lamb who was slain. Through your death and resurrection, you made a way for true reconciliation, true friendship to happen. And you make a way for us to be in true friendship with one another, that we can experience shalom. God, for those of us today who find ourselves in the seat of the oppressor, where we have hurt somebody, where we have kept somebody down, forgive us. I'm just going to pause for a moment while you ask for God in the quietness of your heart to forgive you for those specific things. Forgive us, Lord Jesus. Transform us, disarm us, free us from the things that drive our appetites and give us an appetite for you. Pray that we would only hunger and thirst for you. And for those of us who find ourselves oppressed today, God, be our lion. Be the judge. Fight on our behalf. Protect us and save us. And when it's safe for us to do so, Lord, lead us in forgiveness, that we might be free to live with your shalom now. And so I will pause for a moment and allow you at home to forgive in the quietness of your heart, an act of the will if it needs to be, if it's not an emotion, to forgive those who have hurt you. Jesus, I forgive. Jesus, let our church be a place of shalom. And let your shalom flow out into our city, into our region, into our world. Let the earth be filled with the knowledge of God as the waters cover the sea this Christmas. Amen.
so much again for being with us this morning and for tuning in. And I'm so grateful for the message that Melissa brought just about this concept of shalom and peace. And I think that's something that we all want and something that we all look for. And if that's not where you're at, if you don't feel like you have that, and maybe you want to talk to someone and just talk through it or get advice or prayer, we would love so much to connect with you. Send an email to prayer@redwoodpark.org and someone will be praying for you. If you want to have a phone call, just indicate that in your email and we'd love to reach out and touch base with you. I'm going to close just with this verse from 2 Corinthians 13. As we go into this Christmas week, I want this to be our verse. It says, "Finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration, comfort one another, agree with one another, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you all. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great week.